But aren't we glad for forgiveness? Even when people treat us the way... No, I'm just kidding. It is great to be here tonight, though. It's great to be in the Lord's house, and we're going to worship together. We're going to hear from God's word, and we're just going to have a great time. Are we ready, Pastor? We're good. So we welcome those of you out there online that are listening tonight. That's kind of why we have to wait around sometimes on Sunday night. We wait for those guys up there to give us the thumbs up, and that way people out there online can listen to the service as well. But we're glad you're here tonight, and I hope that you've come with your cup turned up, expecting to hear from God. Get your hymnals. Turn with me over to page 368. 368, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. Since I started for the kingdom, since my life he controls, since I gave my heart to Jesus, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter. Testimony tonight. Aren't you glad that you can sing that tonight? The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. There's another old hymn over on page 554. 554. Another great song of testimony. It is well with my soul. 554. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regard
my sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul, it is well with my soul. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul.
Go back and sing some more of that. You guys got to sing a little bit now, okay? I like that third verse. The one that says, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not just a little bit of it, Bill. The whole thing got nailed to the cross. And I don't have to bear it anymore. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh, my soul. We better stand and sing that verse again. Come on now. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul,
it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul.
Amen. Remain standing. We're going to sing one more. Put your books away, though. You see, when I was picking out music today, I just sent Susan the songs because I thought they were all in the hymnal. And then I found out when I got here, I thought, somebody copied that and put it on the up on the podium or on the pulpit. And I thought, maybe they sang that this morning. And then I found out, no, it's not in the songbook. Susan had already copied it for me and had it laying here. But it's a song I think that you'll recognize. I don't know, I've been a little bit nostalgic today. We went and heard Scott this morning with some friends, and then we turned around and we went home, and I was sitting there doing my Sunday afternoon usual, you know, half watching the baseball game, half sleeping in the chair, after my wife's told me about five or six times, go take a nap, and I, no, I'm not tired. But I just kept sitting there and falling asleep, and when it was finished, I sat there and I got onto YouTube. Any of y'all ever look at YouTube stuff? One of my favorite things to listen to on YouTube is the Nazarene Evangelist Convention. Now, I don't know if you've ever listened to that or not, but they're from back in the early 2000s, most of them. And they've got some old Nazarene evangelists on there, some of them testifying. If you ever listen to the very first one, I believe it is, you listen to Pastor Robert Dabadine give his testimony. And you'll hear some songs that some of them will be familiar and some that won't. But one of the songs Don and Cheryl Gessner and their son Eric sing is a song that I've learned to love that says, talks about the heritage of holiness that's been passed on. And I don't want to lose it. So I've been a little bit nostalgic today, and I thought, well, you know, I know this is one of those songs you sing on Memorial Day, or some people do. We're going to sing this song, and I think you'll recognize it. It simply says, Precious Memories. Because as I thought about that song, even driving in tonight, I thought about times growing up in my home church with Lake O'Connelly, who'd sit maybe back where John is or something, and every once in a while, I mean, this is one of the most quiet men you'd ever want to meet. And every once in a while, old Lako would get one of those anointings upon him. And next thing you know, old Lako was moving out in the aisle, and I can't do it anymore. But he used to jump, and he'd kick himself in the backside, flipping them old legs up, and just praising the Lord. And I was thinking about Grandma Lambert that sat back over probably where Linda is at my home church. And I'd see her get up in that old handkerchief, waving that old handkerchief. And I'd see her son-in-law, Bill Keffer, sitting on the second row. His son was my best friend growing up. And I'll never forget hearing old Bill Keffer, he'd get blessed, woo! And he'd get one of those things. And I started thinking, even about Elk River. My wife and I, we sit back there in the bad section, they say, the rowdy section. But you know, one of the greatest things that I like about that section is I can't think of the times that we sat back there and we'd watch old Bill Martin get blessed and raise that hand and praise the Lord. And even today, to sit there, and my wife will sometimes pull that camera out every once in a while. She'll take a little picture of Bob Gano when that hand goes up. Or Jim Gerenzer when that hand goes up. Or we think about some of those others like Sister Thaxton. Some of those, the Surfaces. Some of those others that through the years have had an impact on our lives. And I'm sure if I came down to you tonight, you'd be able to tell me some of those people. I could talk to Dreema about some of them old folks up here at the Rand Church that had an impact on her life. And I just wonder tonight, so many times do we just forget about some of those people? We say, well, we don't want to live in the old days. That's right, we don't want to live in them. But we can't forget them either. There's hardly a funeral that I've ever done that I probably haven't said, don't let the memories die. You can't let the memories die. And tonight we're going to sing a few verses of this song, and I want you to just think about some of those people. I think you'll know a lot of this. It's an old song. Sing it with me. Precious memories, unseen angels sent from somewhere to my soul, how they linger ever near me, precious sacred scenes unfold, precious memories, how sacred scenes unfold. Precious Father, loving Mother, fly across the lonely years and old home scenes of my
childhood in fond memory appear. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. Stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. As I travel on life's pathway, know not what the years may hold. As I ponder, hope grows fonder, precious memories flood my soul. Precious memories, how my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold.
Susan's going to keep playing that song. I mentioned some of those from my childhood. I was thinking coming in, I've heard Kathy talk about a gentleman down, I believe, in Greenbrier County that made a difference. I could look back and I could think of Pap Shank and Granny Shank. I can think of so many. I never had the chance to meet Sue's dad, but I met her mom. And oh, what a great lady. I just think tonight, maybe during our prayer time, we ought to just take a few moments and say, God, thank you for the memories that you allowed for me to have with those people that made a difference in my life. I'm where I am today because of them and the lives that they lived in front of me, and the lives that they lived in front of you. So tonight, I just want us to, those that want to, if you want to come to the altar and thank God for those people, if you just want to sit in your seats and thank Him, I'm going to let you do whatever you want to tonight during prayer time. But let's sing that chorus one more time and let's get ready to pray.
Precious memories, how they my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold.
You may be seated. Father, tonight we are grateful for who you are. Father, tonight we are grateful for the memories. Here on this Memorial Day weekend, as we think of those that have gone on. Traditionally, Father, we remember those that lost their lives in service to our country. But we can't help but think about those that have gone on through the years that have played an impact and had an impact on our hearts and on our lives. Men and women of faith that live their lives in front of us in such a way that we might know how to live, that we may know right from wrong. People that taught us to pray. People that taught us the importance of being in God's house. People that taught us the importance of giving. People that taught us the importance of loving others and being accepting of others. What an impact they've made on our lives. And Father, tonight as we think about those individuals that had an impact on my life and an impact on the lives of those that sit in this room tonight, as those at home think about those that made an impact on their lives. Father, tonight we just want to say thank you for those precious memories. But as we've already said, we can't live in the past. The battle still rages on, and you've still called us to live our lives in the midst of a sinful world. But Father, our paths were much easier to bear when we look back and see what those people made it through and realize they did make it through and that we can make it through as well. Father, tonight I just pray that as we have gathered here in this place and in your presence, Father, that you would help us to be mindful of those. And Father, help us in our own little space wherever we are to just say thank you for those that live that life in front of us, that we may know how to live the Christian life today. Father, I pray that tonight, that as we've gathered here in this place, that as your presence has already met with us and is here, I pray, Father God, tonight that you would be with Mike as he breaks the bread of life. Use your servant tonight, Father, as he shares what you've laid upon his heart. Father, bless our time together. Everything we say, everything we do, may it bring praise, honor, and glory to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Would you pray for Pastor Mike as he comes? And don't forget, folks, starting next Sunday night, the party's getting ready to start. Bible school. And so if you want to help with Bible school, you see that lady right there, she'll put you to work, guaranteed.
No, thank you. You were talking about heritage, and my dad didn't accept Christ till I was six. And my mom, she was a shouter in the Baptist church, and I would get so embarrassed as a teenager for my mother to be up in the choir and doing all this. I was just like shrinking down. But you know, that's one of my best memories. And right before she was died, she was 95, and I went into the house and I said something, Mom, how was your day or something? She said, let me tell you, Jesus has been here. She had her Bible out, and she was praising the Lord by herself in her home. And that is a great heritage. And you were talking this morning, Emily's already asked for my Bible that I had when she was young, but she wouldn't take any of the dishes, my mother's dishes. But how thankful I am that maybe I am shining a light for Jesus.
Nobody going to talk to me tonight. Anybody have a testimony? Okay. I got a marketplace here. Amen.
And I do love that song, Precious Memories. It does bring me back to that tiny little Baptist church on Teaberry Road in Greenburg County when I was just a child. And Lynn Green and his brother Toby, they were at that time in their 80s, and they gave candy out to the kids, which is why they were so popular with us. But more than that, Lynn, Mr. Green, he took me in and shared his Sunday meal with me, what little he had. But more than that, I remember him getting out all those old songs, and he would teach them to me. I was only like 10 years old. But that did leave a lasting memory, Joe. He at 80 invested in my life, because he knew my mom was gone, my dad was gone. Amen. I lived with my grandparents at the time. He knew I needed him, but more than anything, I needed God. As even as a child, I needed to know my father cared for me. And I am so thankful that those memories still flood, and I can still hear him and his broken voice at 80, leaning up against an altar because he couldn't stand, because his feet were crippled from a railroad accident. And he would lean against that altar and he would sing a cappella. He didn't have a beautiful pianist. He didn't have an accompaniment tape. He would sing in his voice. Come home at supper time. Amen. Was it one of the favorite songs he sang? Amen. Now I know what he meant. And I am so thankful that God puts people in our path at the time in which we so desperately need them. And I am thankful, like Brenda this morning,
Amen.
When people respond to the voice of the Lord and do what God has asked them to do, because they really don't know the impact they will have years later.
Amen.
I will see him again.
Amen. Yeah.
And I can't wait, because he won't have crippled feet
Amen. God's anymore. So good.
I can't wait. To see you, but just say thank you.
Amen. Me either. Anybody else? Please.
I always want to have a testimony for the Lord when I can. My mom, I know when they got saved to the uttermost. And mom was, of course, she taught me a lot. There were people here in church like May Thaxton. I went up to the altar one time and she told me to be still and be still and trust in God. And I thought she just wanted me to shut my mouth, but it worked. But I want to give God the praise for everything in my life.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Just burning. All right. I will tell you. You going to give it to somebody or am I going to talk? One of the things that I remember, and I wasn't even going to say this, but that song just brought it out. December the 12th, 1999, I was ordained. And that day my mother came to the church here in Charleston. They lived in Oak Hill. And as typical, they always asked the pastor that was being ordained to say the closing prayer of that service. And I turned, and I don't know why, and I said, Mom, how about closing the service for us today? She did, and I thought it was beautiful. We get to the front of the church and shaking people's hands like you always got to do when you're a preacher and all that kind of stuff. And she says, Mikey, she said, I'd have prayed a better prayer if I'd known you was going to ask me. I said, Mom, it's about the prettiest prayer I've ever heard in my life. I had a request to preach at another church that night. They were having some internal problem. They wanted me to do a message, and seldom do I do a message as a subject, but about how to have church harmony in the church. I said, sure. So I go up, and we get home a little bit later. And back then, I'm so old, we didn't have these automatic things on your cell phone. We had answering machines. And the light would bleep, bink, bink, and it'd be red. And you had to hit a button. You had to rewind it and do all this stuff and finally get the message. And on that answering machine that night, there was a message for my brother. It says, Mikey, come to Oak Hill Hospital and identify Mom's body. Wow. I said, what in the world? I told Cindy, I played it again. I said, this can't be so. So we called, and I couldn't get a hold of my brother. Our son was on the police department. We finally get a hold of him, and he hadn't heard anything. And he checks, and sure enough, Mom had died. She went to the church that evening after she got home at 7 o'clock. She went to church. She's sitting near the back, as the paramedics tell me. She was sitting near the back, and she said she'd gotten hot during the song and took her coat off. They were singing, and she fell to the floor, and she was literally dead. Paramedics said she couldn't have lived a minute. What a way to go. But we get to the hospital that night, and in that sterile room with the stainless steel equipment, with the stainless steel table, I walked in, and their mom was laying. And I want to tell you, and this will sound silly to some people, the most blessed, beautiful sight I've ever seen in my life. Not because Mom was going, all that broke my heart, and I had tears. I've hurt and still have tears of hurt. But I want to tell you what, my mother was a Christian. Her early life, she wasn't. But I knew how she'd spend eternity. And wow, the memory I have is that memory solidified. It just seems like the Holy Spirit filled that place as I had seldom seen. And isn't it a blessing to know that you know that you know? I love that. A little bit different message than I normally preach. Always when I preach someplace else, the first thing I ask Cindy when I call her, how was church? She said, you missed a good service today, Mike. Said the music was good, the roses were good, and said the pastor even preached a good message. And I said, what do you mean even preached a good message? I couldn't understand what she was trying to say to me. But I'm always glad as our church does good. And I just share that because I love our church. I seldom preach this way, so bear with me. I told Billy Wildman that I get nervous when I preach, and I don't apologize for that. That's okay, because I want to do right, not for me, but for God. The title of the message, and I even seldom title my messages, No Flowers for Jesus' Grave. Now think about that a minute. No Flowers for Jesus' Grave. I want to talk a bit about Memorial Day first. Originally established during the Civil War, Memorial Day honors those who have died in military service for the United States. Recent history, Memorial Day has been the official, unofficial start to summer. I often think about the hot dogs and the hamburgers and the watermelon and all that stuff that goes with it. Some of you nodding your heads, yeah, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Memorial Day, originally known as Decoration Day, is a federal holiday in the United States for honoring and mourning the U.S. military personnel who died serving. From 1868 to 1970, it was observed on May 30th. Since 1971, it's observed the last Monday of May. I had the distinction when the Desert War first started. I got a call, and when our chaplains at the Armory were out of town, they often would call me and ask me to serve chaplain-like duties. I wasn't an Army chaplain, but they asked me to do some of those duties. And one of our soldiers had gotten shot in the war. We talked briefly about him just the other day, Cindy. And they want me to go down and notify the family. So the rules are such that I think it's after 8 o'clock you can't tell somebody their family had died, or before a certain time you can't the next day. So early the next morning, an officer named Colonel Bob Hamill and I went down to tell this lady that he had died. And it really called me to ponder the men and women that had given their lives that you and I could be free today. I pray we never forget, that we never forget what they have done for our country. Memorial Day is a time of memory, a time of love, a time of precious memories from yesterday year, if you will. About a week ago, our time's a little bit messed up this year, and we went to Cindy's mother's grave and her twins' graves, and we wanted to take flowers, we wanted to honor the graves and do those things that we feel is a duty or an obligation. We're going to go to my mom and dad's grave while we're in Somerville this coming week. We took flowers. She went and she bought these flowers. Oh, they're expensive, aren't they? Can you believe what they're charging for flowers today? But they're expensive. She gets these flowers, and we take them and push all the stuff back, took up all the old stuff, and it was a good time. We remember the past and some of the things that had happened in the past and the way that things have happened. We laughed, and there was some misting in the eyes. We reminisced, but we also looked to the future. There's some things that we need to do. Just the other day, I heard on the news down at the Kennard Veterans Cemetery that they were asking for volunteers because they were going to put flags, United States flags, on all the graves. What a beautiful sight it is when you walk into a grave, and for all those that have honored America to see all the, I like the word beautiful, flags for what they mean and all. Over the years, I've done multiple presentations at cemeteries on Memorial Day. I went to one time, and I don't know what they thought. It was up at Flatwoods. They asked me to come. Some people asked me to come and all, and I went up. I'll tell you what, if I'm going to do a presentation, Jesus is going to be part of it. I don't care who it is or what it is. And a couple of them looked at me like, is he really talking about Jesus, this thing? They didn't really chastise me, but we're to tell people about Jesus. Some people have to go to family cemeteries. I was talking to Bill Cavender, and he was up and going to the cemetery, and he got there, and Bill, if I tell this wrong, you're welcome to chastise me, but he's going to the cemetery, Curtis Cemetery, I believe. Nope, that's your cemetery. What's the name of it, Bill? The one that you're going to clean off had already been cleaned off? Okay, he went up there to clean off, and somebody had already cleaned it off. What a blessing. So we have responsibilities that come with the memories and all. We drive past the cemeteries and we see all the flowers and the flowers and more flowers. It's beautiful when you see them all decorated. And I can just imagine that people that cut grass getting really aggravated because they got to cut around those things. And they want you to take them up as soon as you can. Then I ask myself the question, well, wonder why we don't take flowers to Jesus' grave. People loved, some hated him, I know, but people loved him. Books have been written about him. Prophecy told him. He was a great man, the Son of God. Why don't we take flowers to Jesus' grave? Pretty simple. We'll talk a bit about that and everything. Not long ago down at First Church, I did a lesson that talked about the body wasn't there and all. And some people thought that Jesus went into a swoon. He just passed out for a while. And they put him in that grave. And then after a while, he just come out of the swoon and come out. Well, what do you do about the Roman soldiers and the other stuff that would have been there to stop that from happening and all? Some people thought that his body was stolen by the apostles and those that loved him. Here again, the Roman soldiers. What would you have done about that? Some even thought that he didn't even die. There were other reasons. Some thought it was a spirit. They had a spiritual resurrection. It wasn't the body. Some thought he was put in the wrong tomb. I want to tell you what, and this isn't even in my notes. Jesus arose. He come forth from that grave alive and well. And the world would love to take that away from us, but you know what? They can't. They just can't do it. We'll go to Isaiah 53. All of you know it. Most of you know it. I'm going to read out of the NIV. I love this because here the great prophet Isaiah was foretelling what Jesus was going to have to go through for his death. Isaiah 53. Jack Kudel loves Isaiah 53. And it says, who has believed? The King James says, our report. The NIV says, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He hath no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should deserve him or desire him. It goes on to say, he was despised and rejected by mankind. A man of suffering, familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely, according to verse 4, he took up our pain. He bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. Oh, it's hard for me to read this and not cry. But he was pierced for my transgressions, is the way I read it. The book says for our transgression. But for my transgressions, for my sins, he was pierced. He was crushed for my iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, or by his stripes, I believe the King James says, we are healed. I am healed because of Jesus. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each one of us has turned his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he openeth not his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and a sheep before its shears is silent, so did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of this generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Verse 10. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Verse 12. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great. He will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. I read this when I'm reading it for me, for he bore my sins. It says, for he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Father, we love you. Oh, we love you. And God, we love your word. And God, we believe you gave us your word for a purpose. And that is so that we can draw closer to you, to learn more of you, learn to love you. But God, so that we can understand salvation, we can understand how that we can work better for you. But God, this particular section tells us in prophecy how Jesus was going to die. We thank you for him, for Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. I heard the phone ring, and years ago, I was doing a funeral. And right in the middle of the funeral, right when you're trying to get the punchline across, as some people would say, and the West Virginia University fight song comes on. Gotta love it, don't you? I love the scripture. And if we understand, Jesus was placed in a borrowed tomb. It wasn't even his tomb. And he was placed there. People claim to know exactly where it was. And there were witnesses that saw him put there. Jesus told his disciples that he was going to be destroyed just a little while ago. Just a little while before his crucifixion, he told his disciples that the temple would be destroyed and rebuilt in 3 days. And they were just like us. They couldn't understand exactly what that meant. They struggled with it. When he died, they just couldn't believe this had happened at all. He talked to them about his death, and he talked to them about his resurrection. When he talked to them about the temple, they couldn't understand. John 2:19 says, Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and I will build it again in 3 days. However, the temple Jesus was referring to, in my words, was his own body. After Jesus resurrected, they remembered and they believed the scripture. He had told John to take care of his mother. Can you imagine there on the crossing, and as this all come about, and Jesus looked at John, his beloved, and he said, I want you to take care of my mother. And mom, this is now your son. He did that because he loved them. And you say, Mike, why are you telling us this in this message? Because I want us to understand that Jesus knew he was going to die, and he did die, and the world would love to take that away from us. I love the thoughts of Easter morning. Can you imagine? Can you just imagine for a moment? Now, Peter was kind of an impetuous man, kind of like some of us, kind of just always on the edge, just kind of always doing things. He's like me, and I always got to talk about popcorn when I preach. When you pop microwave popcorn, you sit 3 minutes. Well, 2 minutes and 80 seconds, I'm ready to take it out. That's the way Peter walked. He couldn't wait for it to get done. Now, he didn't walk to Jesus' grave. He didn't walk up there with great sadness and everything, although he was sad. He ran to that grave. And they literally were racing each other to see what was going on. And when they got there, guess what? Glory to his name. He wasn't there. Now, I want to tell you what. I'd have had a heart attack. I got a pacemaker. Anybody else have a pacemaker? If you had a pacemaker, you'd understand. That thing kicks off and goes crazy. And I'd have had a heart attack if that happened to me at all. They ran. I want you to turn to John 20, please. John chapter 20, verses 3 through 10. I'll give you just a second. And one of the reasons I want to talk about his death for a few minutes is that grave is empty, but he did die. And the reason we don't take flowers at Jesus' grave is because the song goes, ain't nobody there, and ain't no grave going to hold me down. Luke 22, that's the wrong one. Let me get back to the right place. John 23 through 10. Sorry about that. So Peter and the other disciples, they started for the tomb. Both were running. Can you imagine them running? But the other disciple outran Peter. Now, Peter wouldn't like that, I'm sure. Now, I suspect Peter was a little chunky like me and probably couldn't run too fast. You know, it just wasn't working for him that day. And he reached the tomb, Peter, and reached the tomb first. He bent over, looked at the strips of linen lying there, but he didn't go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the stripes of linen laying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and he believed. He saw and he believed. Wow. They still didn't understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. The disciples went back to where they were staying. He was put in that tomb. He was put in that gravesite. If Jesus died and still in the grave, we would still be placing flowers on his tomb. But he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. Our Savior lives. He's not, I told him this morning in church, I didn't do this message, but I told him this morning in church, all these other gods, and I even hate to say other gods because they're not really gods in my way of looking. All these other gods are dead. There's no other gods except Jesus. We make things God, but God is the only true living God. And this stuff that people are trying to paint before us as good and God and God-like is just baloney. We don't have to go, and I love this. But before Jesus, we had to go to the priest on the Day of Atonement to have my sins forgiven. Some of the things I've done, I'd been ashamed to tell the priest. Some of you nod your head, you understand exactly what I'm saying. I'd been ashamed to tell him. And that priest talked to God on my behalf. Guess what? When Jesus died, he became the one mediator between God and man, God and men, the man Christ Jesus, for you and for me. When I pray, God hears my prayer. He answers my prayer, and he knows that I'm praying. We got to get flowers. If Jesus' tomb were still there as such, we got to go to the cemetery. We got to mourn. But we don't have to do that. We don't have to take flowers. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. Got to keep the gravesite clean. Talking about Bill and everything. You riddled through this message, Bill. Got to keep that gravesite clean. Got to keep it. Got to keep all the brush. That wasn't a brush because it was in the cave. But we had to keep all the brush and all the stuff off it. No, sir. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. But we are to remember him. We are to remember him. And I'll tell you some reasons. Luke 22, 19 through 20 says, and I want to read this first. And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this, and I think the King James says, as oft as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup, after they had eaten, saying, this cup that is poured out for you is a new covenant in my blood. So Christ knew he was going to die. He wanted us to remember what he went through. He wanted us to remember his teachings. He wanted us to remember him. So he wanted to leave this what are the words that we use? Communion. That's not the word I wanted to come up with. But he wanted to leave this so we'd have a memorial to think about him. And as often as we do, to what? To think of him. And we think about what he went through, but we look at the fact at that time that he's coming back, that our sins are forgiven through his blood. I love communion. We went to a church one time, and we had some interest in it before we came here, and they were going to have communion. We found out we couldn't have communion with them because we weren't a member of that church. Now, I'm here to tell you that's not scriptural. I didn't get any amens. That's not scriptural. The church is the body of Christ, the body of believers. It doesn't matter where you go or what country you live. That's the church. And if we can't take brother communion with our brothers and sisters here, what are we going to do in the kingdom? We ain't going to be if we can't take it with our brothers and sisters here. Forgive the bluntness there. No, don't forgive that. That only forgive them. Not only is he not dead, he's still working for you and I. Now, if Jesus were dead, he wouldn't be in heaven on the right hand of God the Father interceding for us, would he? If he were dead, he wouldn't do that, would he? That defies all logic, and God's a logical God. Nod your heads. Anybody asleep? All right. It defies logic. In Romans 8, 34 through 37, who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus died. Even the scripture says he died. More than that, he was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also what for us? Interceding for you and I. Through his blood, We talked about Isaiah 53, where we talked about the shedding, the prophecy of the shedding of the blood. We could go back and we could talk tonight, I don't have time, about how awful the crucifixion was, about everything they did to him, how they spit on him, how they whipped him with a cat of nine tails, how they cursed him, how they did all those things to him. But you know what? He still loves us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we will face death all day long. We're considered a sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we're more than conquerors through him, through Jesus that loved us. You and I are conquerors. We don't have to lay down. We don't have to put up with this stuff the world wants to put out. We'll come back to America and our soldiers just for a moment. I think sometimes the men and women that have given so much for America to be free, if they could, and this is very flip, if they could, they'd turn over in their graves and see some of the stuff that's going on today. Now, I know they're not going to turn over a grave. Don't go say that. Preachers preach on weird stuff. I do preach weird stuff, but that's not what I'm saying. They would be upset with all the things that's going on in America. We have turned our back on the Almighty God in so many ways, so many places, so many times. And people cry out, oh, I'm concerned for America. Then why don't we, the church, do something about it? Why don't we lift up the name of God? Our Savior lives. He lives today. He is not dead. He's not in that tomb. I didn't take a flower over there and have to hunt that place where he's buried. He's alive and he's well and he's interceding for you and me. But you know, it doesn't stop there. He's coming back. Glory to his name, he's coming back. I got chill bumps, I'm telling you. Oh, the hair's even standing up. That's pretty cool when you get that kind of chill bumps in it. I love it. He's coming back someday. I don't know when. People have tried to calculate when, and they just don't know. The Bible says nobody knows the day or the hour, not Jesus, not the angels in heaven, just God knows. And he's waiting just a little while longer so that just one more might be saved. And church, that's our job now, is to win others. Too many times we come to church saying, the church is just for me. I want to tell you what, this building is to win the lost, to go out here on the streets and out here on the parking lot and tell people about Jesus. That's why he died, so that we could be forgiven and we could share the good news. Remember the last verse of Matthew. Go out and win them. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's what we're supposed to do, and we don't do that so much. And churches have watered down so much of the gospel. We were at Myrtle Beach, and the pastor down there, where we were attending church, he come in, maybe at Easter Sunday morning, I am not sure. But he come in, and some big mega church in America had put out on the internet, and it was fact. I went back and checked it out, and you can't believe everything on the internet. It's not what I'm saying. But he had put out that in his church on that Sunday, on Easter Sunday, they weren't going to talk about the blood. They weren't going to talk about the resurrection, that you really didn't need that. I don't know what Bible he's reading, but he ought to throw the one he's got and get one like I got. And we need to tell people that we ought not sit under that watered down stuff that doesn't mean anything when it comes to Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. About to get wound up here. Christ is going to return someday. The trumpet is going to sound. The clouds are going to roll back. He's going to say, church, come on. I'm ready to go. I told some of them the other night, I said, you know, I like living. Anybody else like living? Rest of you will go ahead and take you to the funeral home. I like living. Don't you like living? I enjoy my popcorn. I saw you grin back there. I enjoy my popcorn. There's nothing better than a Coke and a bag of popcorn. I don't think I'm going to have it in the kingdom. Don't think I am. But I enjoy living. But you know what? I'm ready to go. Isn't it great to know that our sins are forgiven? Isn't it great to know that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, we read in Revelation 53, that was for you and for me. We have to accept it. We have to accept it. The soldiers that died gave their lives for our freedom. Slowly, that freedom is being eroded away from us. Now, I love this country. I stand when the Pledge of Allegiance is said. I stand when the national anthem is played. I salute the flag of the United States of America. I say the pledge to the Christian flag. I believe what it stands for. I say the pledge to the Bible. I'm terrified for our land. These men and women gave us the freedom to worship, the freedom to be here. This is a great land. I get grieved over the way immigration is handled. It's the only place that people are beating down the walls to come to. There's got to be something right here, or they wouldn't be wanting to come, church. It's time we lifted up the name of God. We've got the freedom to pray. That grave's empty. We got the freedom to pray, and I don't have to go to Randy Lipscomb. I love Randy. Don't y'all love him? Say yes. You know, if I helped you along there in case anybody wanted to say no. I love Randy. I really do, and he's a great man. But I don't have to pray to Randy or through Randy. I can pray on my own to God because Jesus died and because that grave's empty and because I didn't take any flowers there today. We have freedoms that others can't understand because they don't have it. We need to be careful. This is talking about America for a moment, of who we get in bed with. The people of many of these countries are probably good people. Most likely they are good people. They need God. But China despises what we are. They would not let us be here if they were in charge. Russia has the same thing. North Korea, the same thing. They can't stand the fact, one, that we serve God, two, that we're free, and two, that we're affluent. And the reason that we're affluent in this nation, because God has blessed America. I believe that with every ounce of my being tonight. I'm going to ask you to remember three things as I close, if I might. One, many have given their lives that you and I can be free. Be thankful. Be thankful. Two, our loved ones, my mother, has a promise of eternal life, as we do. And three, no need to leave flowers at Jesus' grave. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. I don't have to go to Walmart. They're cheaper at Walmart in these stands. I don't have to go to Walmart and buy this big thing of flowers and come to the church in memory of Jesus. Okay, if we do it to honor Jesus. But Jesus isn't dead. Jesus is not dead. And it's time the church knows he's alive and he's well. And I'm excited about it, church. Then after you remember those things, I want you to think, Jesus is going to return. I don't know when. I'm excited about that. I hear some preachers, they go over to Revelation 21 and 22 and then some of the other great books about what the kingdom's going to be like, and they try to describe it. And they talk about streets of gold and walls of jasper, and they talk about this stuff, and they try to describe it. I don't do that very much because I can't describe it. It's going to be so great and so wonderful. And I'll tell you this one thing. If God's doing it, it has to be right. And God is doing it, therefore it is right. Everybody good with that? Hope it made sense. He is coming back. Be thankful. Be thankful for an empty tomb. Be thankful for a risen Savior. Be thankful for salvation. Father, we love you. And God, we've done our best, Lord, to lift your name tonight. God, I love it when I get chill bumps and the hairs on my arm just stand up because I'm just saying, Mike, you're right there. I love that, God, and thank you. Lord, I thank you for our church family. Lord, I thank you for the men and women that died that we could have our freedoms. I thank you for the heritage, Lord, of our loved ones. That song of Joe led us in precious memories. God, how great to think back about those that meant so much, Lord, to you and to us. God, I think about today and where we are, and I think about our church and Lord, our pastor and our choir and the groups and everything that goes on. And God, you have blessed us. You've blessed us so much. And I pray, God, that we'll never let that fire go out at Elk River. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, I look to the future knowing that Jesus will return. So bless your word. God, I pray that everything that's said and everything that's done will be for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Don't put flowers on Jesus' grave. God bless you. Thank you.